I guess I should start by introducing myself. That's me in the blue. My name is Diego. This is the favela of Rocinha as it looks today. Situated in the south zone of Rio de Janeiro, it is said to be the largest favela in Latin America. I had the opportunity to live there, and now I'd like to take you on a visual journey of the place I learned to love and now call home. I will start at the highest point and work my way down. There are no maps of Rocinha, since the drug dealers won't allow it. So we'll start at the top, visiting various houses, then we'll discover what people do for fun, we'll visit some parties, the local market and fair, and finally end up where the favela ends. At the beach. Just 70 years ago, this mountain was just a barren hillside on an uninhabited coast of Rio. In the 1940s, the first squatters took over the land. However, its population boom occurred in the 1960s with the construction of the nearby suburb of Leblon, and again in the 1970s with the construction of the high-class area called Barra da Tijuca. Because of this, most of the migrants came from the northeast of Brazil, specifically the states of Ceará, Pernambuco, and Paraíba. Unemployment, cyclical droughts, and landlessness conditions forced many poor families to leave their homes and migrate to the big city in search of jobs and a better life. Once in Rio, these migrants encountered inflated property values, which forced them to squat in Rocinha. Today, it is the largest favela in Brazil and boasts a population of between 100 to 300,000 people, depending on the source. 67% of the families have a head of the household making less than $80 a month. In addition, only 57% of the buildings are linked to the public sewer system. Amidst this extreme poverty exists a functional community like any other. There are restaurants, banks, dental offices, grocery stores, and even dance clubs. However, the favela is infamous for more than just being a poor community. Rocinha is notorious throughout Brazil as one of the most dangerous favelas. This is due to the nature of Rocinha's most visible economic presence, drug dealing. It is the drug dealers that serve as government and police in the community, and because of this, Rocinha has gained a reputation as a chaotic and dangerous place. So naturally, the average Brazilian is scared to enter or even pass by Rocinha. Knowing this, I was a bit nervous about living there, but I couldn't pass up the opportunity. Once inside, the severe poverty becomes a reality, and the evidence of a rough life becomes painfully obvious. After a short time, I quickly learned that most of the reputation was just myth. Most of it. But there was the night that the police invaded and had a shootout with the local drug dealers. I was just walking home one evening down a dark alley. When I heard gunshots all around me. It was too dark to see anything, so I just ducked into a doorway and waited. The alleys of Rocinha can become a scary place just by themselves. Add in gunfire, and it's enough to make your heart jump. So I learned that not all the rumors were false. After a few days, I quickly made friends. These people welcomed me and opened their lives to me as if I were one of their own. Maybe it was because I was a foreigner, but the people in Rocinha were even more friendly to me than the typical famous hospitality of the average Brazilian. I'm going to begin our tour with Orlando's house. He is my closest friend in Brazil and lives towards the top of the mountain. Orlando is a typical male resident of Rocinha, and he is one of the lucky ones. He once had a job and saved enough money to buy his own house. He was also able to buy his own TV and computer. For the rest of his appliances, he had to be creative. Resourcefulness is one thing that impressed me about Rocinha residents. You see, Orlando doesn't have his own phone line. He spliced a line from his brother's house down the street and connected the cord to his house. It is not uncommon for one phone line to serve several households.
Yeah, give us a tour. Geladeira. Magnets. Gotta have magnets. Stove. Modern plumbing.
Sometimes they put a sink. All they need is a bucket in a nearby bathroom. Orlando's and most other houses in Rocinha are a combination of modern meets primitive. Most have TVs and stereos, yet may lack some basic plumbing or phone services. Orlando's bathroom is modest yet practical. It has everything he needs, including a large window to the living room. Next, Orlando filmed his mother's house for me, which is just up the alley from his house. There's his mom, proud mother of eight. During my stay in Rocinha, I saw many houses like this. You'd never know by the looks of it, but seven people live in this one-bedroom house. This isn't all that uncommon. The people have such tight-knit families and are used to such small places and lack of privacy. In most houses that have small children, you will always find plenty of string to make kites. Kite flying is the unofficial favorite pastime of Rocinha. Once again, we see a humble kitchen, yet at least the sink has its own plumbing. One advantage to living in the favela is the view. And finally, here is the one bedroom in the house. A while later, I found myself on Orlando's roof admiring the view. From his roof, you can see an amazing panoramic view of the whole favela. The longer I stayed on the roof, the more I noticed kites flying all around me. This is a common pastime for kids, since there is always an abundance of wind from the nearby beach. Kites provide inexpensive entertainment because kids can easily make them at home with paper and string. At any time, if you look closely, you can see kites all over the favela flying from rooftops. Usually, by the age of 10, kids are expert kite flyers. In Rocinha, Rooftops aren't only used to fly kites and dry laundry. In fact, the dojo of one of the most popular sports in Brazil is located on a rooftop just beneath Orlando's house. Besides soccer, jiu-jitsu is probably the most popular sport in Rio de Janeiro. It is a sport that can be practiced by all people, regardless of age or sex. In Rocinha, it is relatively inexpensive to practice jiu-jitsu. The space itself isn't very expensive since it previously was an unused rooftop, and all the equipment that is needed is a kimono, which can easily be obtained as a hand-me-down or secondhand. Jiu-jitsu was first brought to Brazil from Japan in 1914. In 1925, Carlos Gracie and his brothers opened their first jiu-jitsu academy, and Gracie Jiu-Jitsu was born in Brazil. Since then, the martial art has been refined and has become Brazil's own. It is a form of submission ground fighting with an emphasis on leverage and technique. This allows a much smaller or weaker opponent to beat a much larger and stronger foe. For this reason, it is common to see girls of all ages matched up against larger boys. This surprised me at first, since in the sport of American wrestling, which is the closest thing to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, it is uncommon to see girls matched up against boys, or even girls participating at all. But in Brazil, this is normal. Here we see little Jessica taking on a much larger male opponent. She uses quickness and energy to overwhelm him and capture the victory. Here we have Camila taking on a male opponent who looks to be at least 50 pounds heavier than her. Camila has mastered many of Jiu-Jitsu's basic techniques, and because of this can easily apply submission holds. Here she applies an armbar, and it's only a matter of time before her opponent taps out, signaling submission. Another easy victory for Camila. Jiu-Jitsu is so popular in Rocinha that on tournament day, friends and family all turn out for the event. It gets so crowded that it becomes standing room only. It's a time to cheer, relax, and maybe even meet someone new, like I did. After the tournament, the participants receive their awards, then it's time to party. Residents of Rocinha take advantage of every opportunity to have a good time, and a successful jiu-jitsu tournament is the perfect opportunity. On the other side of the rooftop are bottles of Brazilian beer and hot dogs just waiting to be consumed, and everyone has to stick around and drink in order to pay tribute to the participants and to themselves for vigorous cheering. Even the little kids get to stay and party. Speaking of parties, a little farther down the mountain at my apartment, I hosted a birthday party for Orlando. Hosting a party wasn't as easy as I had imagined. It involved a lot more math. Orlando explained to me that for every 3 verbal commitments that we get from girls, only 1 will actually show up. So in order to have 10 girls at the party, we would have to get 30 commitments. And of course he wanted more than 10 girls at the party. So we made a list of all the people that we knew and went to work. First, Orlando called the guys.
Hello, Peter. Hey, tudo bem?
Tá.
Hello, Alex. Tudo bem? Orlando. Alô, Gilhard? Gilhard? É. Alô? Isso, Gilhard.
Then he called the girls. All the girls.
Patrícia?
Orlando tá falando.
Vanessa?
Orlando tá falando.
Alô, Maria Elisa?
Orlando.
Alô, Juliana?
Orlando.
Tudo bem?
Alô, Simone?
Orlando tá falando.
Tudo bem?
Alô,
Silene?
Orlando tá falando. Tudo bem?
Alô, Fabiana?
É, Orlando que tá falando.
Alô, Silvinha?
Tudo bem?
Orlando que tá falando.
Alô,
Diana?
Orlando que tá falando.
Alô, Denise?
Orlando.